Hello, I'm Bishop Jack Wisor. Thank you for joining me to listen to the message that God has given me. I've been helping the poor and the needy for over 17 years, and it's time now that we open up our ears and we start listening to what really needs done throughout our land. The poor, the needy, the inmates, the elderly, our veterans, there's so many people in need. The end is here. It's not going to get better. It's going to get worse on our land. It's time for the Christians to stand up, but we must learn first what's really happening. In my messages, you can learn what is taking place. You can learn how we can stand up together as Christians, as the bride of Christ, and make ready for the coming of our Lord. I'm excited to share this with you. There's a lot of new information in my videos, and I just ask that you would just prayerfully seek God's guidance as you listen to these videos and listen to what God has for you. The homeless are growing. The mentally ill are being challenged in so many different ways. It's time for the church to be real and stand up now, but we need leaders. I'm here to try to lead and teach as God has led me for over 17 years to serve Him, and now having the largest faith-based homeless outreach ministry in Pennsylvania, helping thousands in need, and it is growing. It's time now that we can stand together as we hear God's word, learn together, and let it dwell in our hearts and spirit, that we may truly stand for our Lord, not ashamed, but excited and ready for the coming of our King.
What's the testimony and what started the ministry many years ago? Now, what I'm going to talk about this week, and at least that's what I think I'm going to talk about. It might not be anywhere near it. I don't know once I get going. But I'm going to look a little bit in Matthew 23, the woes of the Pharisees. And it's so much needed because people, our leadership has fallen apart. Our leadership in this country, in our communities, in our townships, our borough, everything has fallen apart.
Right.
And the reason is because God has been removed in many ways.
Right.
And this 17 years of doing this has exposed this tremendously in biblical proportions. But so you have to in this day and age, look, you know, I don't care who you vote for, but is that the best we can do in America? The two candidates for president, is that really the best we can do?
You talk about
when
it.
You think about it. People, you have somebody who is openly a criminal and a liar.
Right.
And then you have somebody that you don't know what to think.
Get them.
You know, and is that really the best we could do? People, all this talking there is money. That's it. You got two people that's loaded with money that's connected to the Queen of England and the Roman Empire, and you start going in to really prophetic events that are taking place. So these things that you have to understand and we need to learn are things we weren't taught in high school or taught in. And the other thing we have to look at, people, is you have to you know, open up your eyes a little bit in your ears. Remember, I've been talking about that a lot. Is this a new guest?
Yes, Bishop.
Hi there. What's your name?
Tim.
From?
Lewiston.
Nice to meet you, man. So, as we move on here, you know, I've been talking about a lot of things. Jesus basically said, my peace I leave with you. And that peace means basically, why don't you just shut up and be still? All right? And that's what Jesus was saying. And he says it all the time. And that's what a lot of us need to start doing, or a lot of you. What you need to do is shut up and be still. Look, your best judgment is put you where you are right now. Put you in the seat you are right now in your life, right where you are. And a lot of it is because you don't want to take the cotton out of your ears and stuff it in your mouth. You know, if you know or think you know everything, then what are you doing here? Or what are you doing in the positions that you're in? What were you doing in a jail cell or in another bad drug deal or wherever? What were you doing there? Because obviously you aren't making good decisions. That's right. So Jesus, we want to come to Christ. And the only time we come to Jesus, usually when we're down and out, right? So you come to Jesus Christ, so instead you start telling him everything you want, should have, or could have, or what you'll do, he'll just do that. And basically what he's saying to you is, why don't you just shut up and listen?
Amen.
And it's something very hard for us to do. He said it many a time. You know, he said, be still. My peace I leave with you, not the peace of the world. He said, if you, that peace means, literally, silence. Just looking in the Bible and you start seeing where Jesus taught. When he cast out demons, what did he do? He silenced them. He basically said, just shut up. The demons are bickering. That's what we do. We bicker, 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 and bicker. Well, Jesus, what are you going to do? Cast us out before our time. You're going to do it. You're going to do that. What does Jesus say? Shut up. I don't want to hear it. And we do the same thing. We come to Jesus Christ all the time. Don't we? And we say, Jesus, give me that, give me that. And we're just going on and on and on and on. How many times have you been on your phone and someone's doing that to you and you go like this with your phone? And, you know, and
right.
You're,
yeah.
You're doing this. Right. You know what? And we do the same thing to Christ, don't we? Yes, we do. We go, and Jesus just said, well, you just shut up and listen.
Shut
that's it.
Amen.
Okay, but we have to have something to listen to. Okay, we have to have some sort of understanding. So you have to take the modern day stuff and try to grasp it first. Okay, you have to understand, who am I going to listen to? Listen, there's some colleges, the colleges in the United States, you know, all of them. What's happened? What's happened? People were falling apart. No one can get along. Just take a look at the world. What's going on with the colleges? Aren't we supposed to get smarter? Is this the best our colleges can do? Is this the best our church leaders can do? No one gets along anymore. Everyone's stressed out. Everyone's greedy. It's all about money, and you can't cope with it, so you turn to drugs, you turn to alcohol, you turn to wrong friends, and it's a mess. But wait a minute. We have these top-notch colleges. You're seeing exactly what Jesus said. A great division's taking place. The rich care less, and they're getting richer. They don't care about the least of these.
That's right.
They don't care at all. They aren't listening to God either.
Amen.
You have a better chance to listen to Christ than they do. They're gone, people. Listen, we can't keep going on into Billy Graham days. We can't keep going on just, you're going to get saved, you got to get it. People were beyond that.
Right.
We missed our mark.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All we do is complain and complain and complain. We want to go and we pray to God. We're asking God, really, do this for us and do that. You really think God's going to answer our prayers, huh? You really think that we're going to go to God as a nation, we're going to pray to God and say, God, we need your help. Oh, by the way, we're going to make gay marriages legal, and we're going to make marijuana legal, and God's going to say, oh, I'm going to bless you anyhow. Why not? No, he's not. Pray about it. People go around, I'm going to go pray about it. Well, you go and pray about it. In the meantime, when you're praying about it, I'll do something about
it. Right.
No, we know works don't get us to heaven. Works is not going to get you to heaven. But it's about time you do something about who you claim to be. That's the problem. These churches go around 99% of the church, and we're going to pray about it. Well, you go right ahead and pray about it. They've been praying about it for decades, and nothing has happened.
That's
Let's
right.
go pray around the flagpole. Well, good for you. You go pray around the flagpole, and I'll fight to keep that door open for the next guest that needs a place to stay.
Amen.
You go
Amen.
Pray about it. In the meantime, I'll do something about it. See, you know why, people? Because I'm going to listen. I'm going to listen to what this Bible says. Now, I'm not going to get into a bunch of, I'm not one. I'll tell you, you bore me with theology and Bible studies and that kind of thing. It's the last thing we need. Once again, colleges, leaders, Bible studies, look where we're at. You got a mess on your hands.
Yep.
You got people that are misusing Christ, misusing this, everything. You know, the other thing, I had a young man come up to me. Again, it bothers me. You know, at 19 years old, I see them come through the ministry a lot. They want to go into the army. Really? You know, now, listen. We have to have the utmost respect for our veterans and for the men who fight for this country. But I spoke to him and I said, you know something? I want you to think real hard. You know, things have changed. You know, right now, we're over there. We got our young men and women that are over there dying so that we can support gay marriages. We can support legalizing marijuana. We can support letting children starve to death. Is that what you want to go and fight? Things have changed.
Amen.
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 That's right. Amen.
You know, it's well, are they really fighting for our freedom? They're over there dying. Well, we're over here carousing, carrying on, having a good time, money, 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 and living it up. And our young men and women are dying for that. Well, we can turn around and slap God in the face and just have, I have nothing against gay people. You want to be gay, that's your choice. Just know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, okay?
Amen.
And that's it. That's all. That's where my department is. Other than that, hey, that's your choice. But the bottom line is, God says this. Now, God loves people who are gay, drug addicts. He doesn't care who you are. He loves you. He forgives you. But this is what he said. Keep it simple. He basically said this. Look, here's what's going to happen. This Homosexuality is an abomination to me. Okay, so God says that. What he's saying is, if you let that happen, it's going to get bad for you. God doesn't want it to happen.
No.
God doesn't make it happen. He's going to let it happen. God didn't send the wrath down. We could do it ourselves. Mm-hmm. Remember the shooting? How many 50-some dead? Mm-hmm. In the gay club? That's exactly what God said. You do that, this is what's going to happen. God says, I'm not going to have to send a wrath on you. You'll do it yourself. He's just warning that if this is what you do, this is what's going to happen. God still loved, he loved every one of those gay people. He loved them, but the bottom line is, he says, you continue to do that, you'll destroy yourself. That's what will happen. These people going around thumping, you know, gays and drug addicts, all saying they're going to hell. No, they might be taking your place there. That's not what this is about. But it's about, you have to understand what's going on in the world in order to know how to listen and stand up for Christ. Unless you want to be religious. And that's what we're going to talk about here, about the Pharisees. Religion, where has it gotten us? Wars and nowhere. Debates and arguments. Churches don't get along. You can't get along in the church. There's church splits. Ministers don't get along. It's just like me. You know, I'm the radical of the bunch, and I always will be. Jesus was, I'm going to be. But, you know, I go into a cemetery meeting, with the cemeterians at the ministeriums, you know, and sit around with them. I don't get along.
Right.
You know, because we're going to go in unity, huh? This is going to be a unity meeting. We're all going to sit there, and I like to say, I'm a proper Roman Catholic, and so on. And I like to go to the Catholic priest and say, well, I'm not Catholic, I'm going to hell, right? Just tell me. Just tell me, will you? Right. I mean, how can we get along and be united if I'm going to hell? Keep or this one over here, if I don't speak in tongues or do a certain thing, I'm going to hell, right? He has to say yes, according to, well, then why are you telling me? Because if I'm going to hell, I'm not against that. I mean, I believe in tongues and gifts, but it's not essential for salvation, but why don't you just tell me that? Or if I have to baptize you in order to go to heaven, why don't you just tell me that? Because how can we be in unity if I'm going to hell, or you're going to heaven, and we're going to put on a big front in the community? Can't be a part of it, see you later, bye.
Right.
Amen.
It's just nonsense. But that's what it is. That's one of the reasons you're here.
That's right.
I was part of the cemetery, and at the beginning, until I started taking in the homeless, and ministers want nothing to do with me.
That's right.
Well, good. That's fine with me. I didn't quit. 17 years later, here we are.
Amen.
Amen.
I kept listening. I kept listening to a simple man. His name is Jesus.
Amen.
He was a simple carpenter. He was a man that knew what it was like to work. He knew what it was like to bleed and to hurt, to have calloused hands. Oh. He knew what it was like to see people hurting and walk among the hurt. He knew what it was like to hunger and thirst. He knew what it was like to long for riches and to be a part. He knows all of our infirmity, but he stayed right there with us. That was it. That's simple. He knew how the Pharisees and the leaders would abuse the least of these and misuse them. I mean, if you want to continue, and you'll hear me for long, if you want to continue to be a product to America and England, then you go ahead, because that's all we are. You're just a moneymaker. Get your food stamps, generate the economy, here you go, we'll give you enough. As long as you stimulate the economy so we can stay rich and keep going. And you got your social security number, you got the mark of the beast, so to speak, etc. You're doing good. I refuse to do that. I will not do that. And you don't need to do it anymore either. How can you sit here tonight, before we even get any further, and you hear me repeat this because it's just appalling. How can you sit here tonight knowing that every 5 seconds a child dies from the effect of starvation in the world? We're Christians now. That's 18 to 20-some thousand a day. Every 42 minutes, one of our veterans commits suicide. mainly because the psychotropic drugs, pseudo-depression, it's fake. Psychotropic drugs are killing people at a rate that is unbelievable. That's called sorcery.
That's right.
The day of Satan. $3.6 trillion business. A lot of us, you know, you end up in there, and thank God I never went that route. But a lot of you have cocktails of psychotropic drugs. They kill. If they don't kill you now, they'll kill you later in life. I've watched it happen through this ministry. Mm-hmm. Now I finally stepped in. I'm going to try to do my best to do something about it.
Amen.
You're a victim. Depression is not in the Bible. Nope. You won't find depression in the Bible.
Nope.
You'll find sad and sorrowful. It's okay. Everyone is. You just need to know how to deal with it. You realize that right now it's probably up to about 150,000. But since 9/11, the estimate of our veterans that die from psychotropic drugs would be now close to 150,000. Why? Because they had PTSD. They took one pill, they had side effects, they gave them another one and another one. They either died in their sleep or committed suicide. 20, 21 years old, young men. But that's okay, because it's making money. Big time money. Now, as we go through this week later on, whether you like it or not, and a lot of people don't like it, you are and will be responsible for it. See, that's something that we've missed. Religion and denominations aren't going to teach you this. They want you happy, and they want you given money. They want you supporting. They want a fellowship country club. That is not what Jesus wants. And it's obvious. Look what's happening in the world.
That's right.
It's obvious, people. But the things that you're going to hear here is what you need to hear. Now you need to do something with it. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you what that is. Only Christ can. All I can do is point it out.
Amen.
A lot of you have been through tough times. I've been through tough times. I'm a recovered drug addict, alcoholic, the whole works. I lost everything. But it wasn't until I decided to stand up for something, and that was Christ. And because of it, this place is here.
Amen.
That's right.
You want to change your life. Number one, you grab on to the most intelligent, wisest person to ever walk this earth. Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And then you get a little bit indignant because of the love that he has for you and died for you so that this kind of stuff wouldn't happen in the world. And then you start fighting for it. Listen, you don't have to fight to get into the kingdom of God, but fight for the kingdom of God.
Right. Amen.
The thing is, nobody is fighting for the kingdom. Everyone's fighting to get into the kingdom of God. Jesus already took care of that at the cross for you. But now you must fight for him. But what does that mean? You have to see it and quit ignoring it. You wake up every day and you go about your business. What you're seeing is Satan. Now people, with that said, because you've got a whole week and a lot of information, I may... Everything as God leads me, as simple as I can for you. Remember these books. You want to truly test yourself with God? Here you go. Try it. You might be surprised. One of these says becoming heaven and becoming hell. 6 months and you got blank pages. Every day you wake up, you have a blank page of your life. You can do whatever you want with it, right? Write down every day what you do for Jesus. open it up. There's your page. Blank page. Brand new for the whole day. What do you do for Christ's life? No, you don't. It tells you, if you don't write down, well, I went to church, I went to Bible study. No, none of that. What have you done for your Lord and Savior, the life of Jesus? What did you buy for him? What did you do? Now, on the hell side, you wake up and you write down, now, what did I do for Satan? Oh, boy, here we go. Try to get out of that one. You do your own evaluation. Now, the thing is once you sign these little books, it's just between you and God, no one else. Your little journal, your little spiritual diary. Once you sign it, you can't quit now. You've got 6 months. Because then if you forget a day, you got blank pages. So you didn't do anything for Christ. Now if you get tired of it and you put it away, and then you pour it out a couple years later, you're going to remember this. Well, I'm kind of speechless, you know. Then the day will come and we'll stand before Jesus, and it won't be these books, but it says, and the books were open. Man, we might gasp a little bit. Well, I don't have anything in mine. Hey, it's between you. You want to try it? Go right ahead. Remember, as soon as you sign your name, you can't do your own evaluation, and you'll start seeing how much the world has messed with us. Oh, I buy my cigarettes, I buy my alcohol, I buy my tobacco, I buy all these drinks, I buy this, I do this. What did you buy for Jesus? I guess when you think about that, you really have to think pretty hard. What do you buy for, what do you buy during the day that would be for Christ? Huh? That's a tough one, isn't it? See, because it works the other way for us. Because, see, right away we think, but instead it's not, what do we buy? Instead we should be writing down, what did we give up? Mm-hmm. So I gave up buying that pack of cigarettes, and I put that funds towards something I know that was putting food in that starving child's mouth.
Amen.
Amen.
You get the point? Now maybe halfway through here you can get yourself somewhere to where then you can finally break this chain and make your decision. Am I a child of hell? Or am I truly a child of the living God? I will guarantee if you do something like this, and this is what I put together as God, you do it however you want. I guarantee if you do, it'll change your life. As a true Christian. That's not religion. That's a personal evaluation of who you are. If you're willing to do it. Here's a good one now. I followed Pokemon. Wow. Talk about damnation to hell. What's up with that? Now, how do you put it in here? Well, I follow Jesus, but over here I follow Pokemon, and it's like, man, talk about vomit being lukewarm, you know, hot or cold or what? What do you call that stuff? I mean, you could really get yourself taught some lessons here, couldn't you? Every time we try to fix ourselves, we think of past friends, drugs, alcohol, bad choices, bad decisions, because we don't know how to apply Christ to our life. We don't know how to shut up and listen. So if we go to Matthew, let's go to Matthew 23. And in order to even begin to understand people, we have to not beat ourselves up too much because of a number of reasons. We are not responsible until we hear the truth and we know the truth and then we deny the truth or don't accept the truth. Okay? And that's another very personal thing between you and Christ. So that is why my responsibility to you is basically to point out the Bible and what's going on today in the world so that you can choose and decide what you want to do. Now, you come to me and ask me what my doctrine is, I'm going to say right here, take a look.
Amen.
Matthew 25:31-46. This is it. 24/7, around the clock, mm-hmm. the doors are open for anybody in their time of need.
Amen.
Not by works, because Jesus commanded it.
That's right. That's
it's right. A command. Amen. He said, if you do that, you'll love me, everyone. And that's how you do that. Everyone. You don't reject anybody.
That's
I don't
right.
judge anybody. As you see, when you come into this ministry, I normally ask you two questions. Unless you're a Raider fan, Oakland Raiders, then I may ask you a few more. But I'll ask you your name and where you're from. That's it.
Right.
Other than that, it doesn't matter to me. God loves you. I love you. That's the way it is.
Amen.
Period.
Amen.
And that's the way it needs to be.
Amen.
It's not like that out there in the other churches.
No, it's not.
It's not. And that's why we're in this condition. So that's the doctrine. That's what needs to be done. And now, a lot comes with that. Because as you do that, and after 17 years, you start seeing how a system starts really messing with people in many ways. And I've documented all that in every avenue, from the psychotropic drugs to incarceration to parole and probation and right down the line to the Area on Aging Agency, CYS. I've addressed every single one in many different ways, and it's not right. So before we can understand our responsibility as Christians, see, we're on this pink cloud thinking that, hey, I'm saved, I'm going to go right to heaven with the Lord, and that's the way it's going to be. Well, you better make sure of that.
Second.
See, call upon the name of Lord Jesus Christ will get you to heaven. That's how powerful that name is. But will you be in the kingdom of God? That's the question you have to ask yourself. Remember, at the great white throne judgment, Jesus is going to stop every single person. And before you cross over into the kingdom of God, a judgment on your heart will be made. Not in front of everybody, it will be between you and Christ. He's either going to say, come into the kingdom of God, or he's going to say, depart from me, I don't know you. How did he base that? Read Matthew 25:31-46, and the end of that great white throne judgment in Revelation. He said, I was hungry and you fed me, thirsty and you gave me a drink. I'm into my kingdom. He's going to look over and say, I was hungry and you did not feed me. People, it's this. Let's just use the first one as an example. I was hungry and you fed me. Well, you provided. And you knew there was a need. And he's going to look over and say to the goats, I was hungry and you did not feed me. They're going to say, but Lord, Lord, we cast out devils. We professed your name. And he's going to say, how in the world could you let a little child die every 5 seconds in the world and call yourself a Christian? See, another thing you have to understand, the faces of sin is ugly, people.
Right.
You get these questions a lot. I get them a lot. Well, why would God let a little child die? Why would God let a child die in a car wreck? Well, that's the face of death. That's the face of sin. Why would God? That's it. God says sin is sin. That's going to be ugly.
Amen.
We can't question that. God is God. But we do know that after that little child dies, they're in the hands of their Creator. That's God's department, not ours.
Amen.
God has covered sin in the cross. His department's done. Now he's going to look at his church, his goats, and his sheep, and he's going to say, wait a minute, you want to question me. How could you let a little innocent child die from the effects of starvation when you're throwing more food away? day, every day in your nation that could feed the world. And you want to question me on such a thing?
Hmm.
See, once we're here, now we're responsible. And I won't get to that tonight, but later in the week, I will get to it. Yes, you are responsible. People, listen, we got to grow up and wise up. You go through the 1900s, the beginning of the 1900s, when they had the insane asylums. Okay? Something that we don't think about. You know why we don't think about? Because it was one of Pennsylvania's secrets and the United States secrets. They shut it down. Now, when I stand up here and I say something, I am able to back it up 100%.
That's right.
Amen.
I mean, in reality, that is. Mm-hmm. When I talk insane asylum, I can take you to one. 362 acres and 50 buildings, thousands, sits right in the center of Pennsylvania, where a place is called the Johnston House, where they kept 40 of the worst women in the state. It started out in the early 1900s, around 1913, 14, 15, 16, for feebly minded women. This was the eugenic period, thanks to the ministers. So see, you got a lot you can learn here if you just listen, but I got, that's why at least I got all week to go over it. But I have to because there's so much information before I can even get to this. But anyhow, you have to understand your leadership and what's happened. Now, I can't get into the Pharisees and begin to show you that until I can show you where we are in our generation and time as a nation and a people. The last thing you need is a Bible study on the Babylonian Empire and Assyrian Empire. You know, that's the last thing you need. You don't even know your own country. You don't even know that this dirt that we're on, we don't even own. We don't even own this. According to the Roman Empire, the Pope owns every single speck of dirt you walk on. We're just borrowing this off of England, by the way. That's all. But anyhow, I can't have time to get into all that. But it was a man who was related to Darwin, the evolutionist. Galton was his name, and started the eugenic period. The eugenic period was, we have to get the feebly minded people out of society, or we are going to decline as a nation. The ministers tried to fight it. Ministers tried to fight that. And they backed off. So much so that they started preaching and teaching that Jesus was a eugenicist. That Jesus came so that he could make a perfect person. That's why where it says in the Bible, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, you can be perfect as the Father in heaven is perfect. They tried to claim that Jesus was a eugenicist and he wanted everybody to be perfect. Now, hold on a minute before you nail Hitler pretty hard, because that was disgusting. Yes, but Hitler learned from the Americans. Did you know that? Did you know that the American eugenics book was Hitler's Bible? He declared it his Bible. So what happened was this movement started. Did you know another thing, people, real quick, so you understand this. You've got to understand all this. The Civil War that created this nation. God creates a nation with blood. The North and the South fought. Blood had to be shed to create the United States of America. Did you know that PTSD started at the Civil War? Did you know, people, it never ended? It never ended. People, men, towns like this, your town you're from, all the men went. When the war was over, the men come home. They weren't the same men that left. They come back and the wives didn't want them anymore. The Civil War was horrific. That is where you got the name hobo, bum, tramp, and PTSD. The hobo with the sack, they were the veterans. When they come back home, they were affected. They were mentally nuts. From the Civil War was such a barbaric, it was a turn from the Napoleon way of fighting to modern day. It was close hand-to-hand combat, not like we know it in our modern World War I and II wars. what you were seeing. You got to know the men that were dying beside you were your friends, people you said. The war wasn't the hours, wasn't hours of combat. It was a half hour, 20 minutes, 50 minutes combat like that. But you had days to sit with your buddies and talk. They would sew their names inside of their coats and write letters and exchange certain things back and forth. They would offer pocket watches to kill each other because of the pain. This was a war that affected our America. They come back, so you got the hobos. Now, here you got towns that are now messed up. The men are messed up, man. They're either nuts, or they aren't the same person that left, or they're dead. So, the women now, how do you think they feel? So they went to the Sears and Roebuck magazine. Guess what you could get in the Sears and Roebuck magazine? Morphine and a syringe. So they started ordering this, and addiction to morphine come into place, to the housewives, to everything. This was in the 1860s, into the 80s. Along comes, okay, here Darwin and Galton and this eugenic period. Now the women are messed up. They say, oh, we got to get all these people out of society so we can be these elite people. So they took the blueprint of England and built the insane asylums in the early 1900s in America and started taking all feebly minded women, they called it, of childbearing age, from childbearing age to 45, and put them in asylums and started sterilizing them. Right. Welcome to America. The war never ended. All got worse. I can take you there. You want to go? I have free reign over the whole place. Mm-hmm. Next week, I said about making hay. You come on with me, get aboard. I'll take you down. I'll show you everything. I'll show you the hospital. I'll show you where thousands of mentally ill, innocent people laid and were butchered to death in the name of science. You want to see that? Mm-hmm. People, you want truth? I'll give you truth.
That's right.
Because this century, the 19th century, will be responsible for that. The 1900s all the way up into the 80s. You don't think of that, do you, when you throw pills in your mouth? You take your psychotropic drugs and anything like that, somebody died so you can have that.
Right.
They were butchered. Now, so as it came to the 1620s and 30s, they started in the 40s, they started the lobotomies. They start all these crazy things. They take an ice pick and run it up your eyelid and rake your brain. Yeah, they were doing that kind of stuff to the women and to the men that later. By the time the 50s comes, when the Johnston House, they start taking the mentally ill women and putting them in basically little rooms. The rooms are still there with a hole in the wall about that big. In the door, I mean. About that big. That's it. You can see the rooms. They might be 5 feet by 7 feet and a door about that big, a hole about that big. Thousands. 1950s, thorazine comes along, so then they start shooting people up with thorazine, and that pretty much puts them in a zombie state, and that was the turning point for psychotropic drugs. By the 80s, they started shutting them down because people started to question. Well, let me back up a little bit, because through the 40s, when this was happening, Hitler's over there, and he sees this. So Hitler takes this eugenic and starts his... Well, they had a big court case, an international court case. Hitler and his medical team, along with the Americans, were all called in. Guess who got to go free? The Americans. All of the American doctors came back to the States innocent, and Hitler took the hit for everything because he said, I'll just throw them in furnaces. And we said, no, we'll just take them back into the woods of Pennsylvania, back into the woods and hide them in a hospital and take them down into a little dungeon and throw them on a table and butcher them. And we'll call it science. The books show that of three surgeons, 75% of the patients died on the operating table from complications. You know why? the belief through that period of the 1900s was that when you were mentally ill, they'll just take out a body organ. And they'll keep removing organs until they figure out which one is causing your mental illness. Well, by the time they remove so many, you die and they just throw you out. And you're lucky if you get a little stone with a number on it. Because at this time, you see people unknown to us, either you hid your mentally ill child in the basement or attic, or you just dropped them off at the asylum, never to see him again.
That's right.
Welcome to America. And we don't call ourselves Christians. It's not a game. Jesus didn't come here to tickle our ears and hold our hands and play games. He came here to show us love and forgiveness for all mankind and then come back and annihilate mankind for their ignorance and their disgusting behavior towards each other. That's the sum of this Bible. I'm sorry. You can read it for yourself.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
I'm not going to back down. I can't help but to think how many of those people lay on that table when I walk into that operating room out in the middle of nowhere. I'm talking a hospital that was built hundreds and hundreds of yards back into the prime forest of Pennsylvania without a waiting room and no parking area. Wonder why. You know what it was filled up with? Four wings. And on each wing was an intensive care unit. That was it. That's how many operations they were pushing through and pushing the people into that. If you made it to the Johnston House, you were lucky. The electric shock is coming back. They're bringing the electric shock back for children and the elderly. I'm fighting that right now. That's what they were doing at this time, the electric shock treatments. The other thing they would do, they had two dentist chairs there. They'd pull your teeth out. They thought if they would pull out all your teeth, it would help your mental illness. That didn't work either. They would treat you basically like an animal. And that was in the teaching that they would, I believe it was Strickland, am I correct? I believe it was Strickland. There was Strickland and there was Pavlov. There were two scientists that were in the medical field that were experimenting in what's known as behaviorism. Remember that word? It's coming back. And it was, I believe his name was Strickland. He actually took his one-year-old daughter and put her in a cage for a year and treated her like a dog. See, before I can even get into this, you have to understand what Jesus was going to tell us about, see? So you have to understand these things. So what he would do is he'd take a dog, he'd put a bowl of food down, and he'd ring a bell, okay? But he noticed as soon as he put the bowl of food down in front of the dog, it would salivate, okay? So he'd ring a bell. So then, after a period of time, he took the food away, and he just rang the bell, and the dog would salivate. Now think, this is Darwin's cousin. So he came up with the conclusion that a child doesn't have a soul. A child is no more than a dog. People look it up. This is where we come from. That a child was no more than a dog. So that's why you got the electric shock, behaviorism theory, all of that. That's why if you go and look it up through the middle 1900s, they're shocking our kids in school. That's where it comes that you can train them like a dog. His own daughter.
Skinner.
Not strictly Skinner. And Pavlov carried it on. Well, they shut it down in the 1980s. Then all of a sudden, you know, people started investigating. They thought, what do we do? So that's why, it's corrupt. So in the 80s, they started shutting down the asylums. And next thing you know, what happened? Remember, it used to be the Barney Fife jails, you know? The Tom Drunk was in jail. There was, then all of a sudden, the prisons filled up because all the mentally ill were now put out into the streets, into the community, and all of a sudden, boom, 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 everything fills up, but the government comes out and fools us by saying, we're going to get tough on crime. Yeah, right. You're going to get tough on crime, all right? You fooled all of us. Now, over a third of the incarcerated, that's about 18,000 average, are mentally ill. My attorneys just won the case for the mistreatment of the mentally ill in the prisons. That's why the population has just went down in the last 2 years from 53,000 down to about 49,000. My federal attorney stepped in and found that the mentally ill are being mistreated, not because they're criminals, because they're mentally ill, okay? So that's taking place right now. But that all came from this eugenic period. So it fills up the prisons, and now what do? The prison experiment is over. Another thing is, people, this is coming off the eugenic period. They had a problem. See, but if you don't know this stuff, you'll never be able to understand what Jesus was teaching. Now, so, at the same time, the reason why the asylums failed was this. No one knew how to deal with the mentally ill. Jesus knew how.
That's right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. He taught us. We didn't know how because we didn't apply faith. The ministers backed down. And see, before the eugenic period, you know what it was? Deliverance. That's what it was. Faith and prayer. Your mental illness, you could be delivered. They left to go. The ministers backed out. They became eugenists. Now the prisons are filled up. You know, another thing that bothers me now, I'm going to tell you a little bit of truth here. And people, you need to know this as Christians. My attorney, Vic, he is pretty much the most powerful attorney in the United States. That's why we're here. His case law, his case law for this in particular case here, was a mentally ill individual stole peppermint patties in the store and was put in jail. By law, anybody with a mental illness has 7 days to be evaluated. So you're evaluated whether you're competent or incompetent. Okay? If you're competent to go through trial, then you do. If you're found incompetent, then you're mentally ill, then you get rehabilitation. Okay? This individual was in jail for 360-some days or more. Never got evaluated. Okay? He stepped in. When he stepped in, he found hundreds of mentally ill that were in this. This was just a few months ago, actually. Maybe 4 months ago. Then he found hundreds that were in our state prisons for 200 days, 100 days, on and on. Then he found the mentally ill in the hole. They were put in the hole, not because they were a criminal, because they acted out in their mental illness. So right now, the state of Pennsylvania has so long to get hundreds out of the prisons, or he's going to file punitive damages. Okay, that's in place. Isn't that sad? No, it gets worse. That's the surface part. So you're going to tell me that in these years, all the wardens, the officers, the ministers, the caseworkers, and everyone else that went in and out of those prisons every day didn't know that the mentally ill were being abused? Seriously?
Lies.
You're going to tell me that. It took a federal attorney to walk in and do this, but you're telling me that ministers and leaders, representatives, senators walked into those prisons and they didn't know that the mentally ill were being put in the hole. They didn't know that the mentally ill weren't getting their medications. Mm-hmm. They weren't getting their medical treatment. Uh-huh. They weren't getting treated properly. You're telling me they didn't know that? Then we're awful stupid, aren't we? Now you see why Jesus came up to the ministers, the leaders, and he hit them hard with the woes. People, there's no excuse for this, and this should get you disappointed and upset.
Amen.
Amen.
You're going to be responsible. Yes, there's people incarcerated that need to be incarcerated. Some of them should be there for life, yes. Some need to go through their punishment, yes, but there are many, especially the mentally ill, that are thrown in there because the asylums were shut down and nobody wants to care for them in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And that's what this ministry is all about,
people. Amen.
There's no reason. Nobody, no one, with all the churches, with all the so-called Christians, not one person with a mental illness should have to be incarcerated. The church should take them in and give them a life.
Right.
That's what I'm trying to do here.
Right.
As Christians, you should be doing the same.
Yeah.
Why are you trying to do that? You could do something about that.
Well,
we might not be able to get the spoon in the mouth of that child in another country, okay, to feed them. But you've got mental illness coming all over the place. And now it's time to do something about it, people.
Well,
you can. But you're going to be responsible. Jesus said, I was in prison and you came and visited me.
Right.
How in the world in the last 5 years are you going to explain that to Christ that it took a federal attorney to release hundreds of mentally ill people out of prisons when ministers walked in and out of there every day? And Jesus said, I was in there, not knowing what was going on. You walked right by me. You didn't care and you knew it.
Amen.
Get him.
Amen.
Let's pray about it. Let's pray about it.
Uh-oh.
It's sad. So now they're coming out into the streets, people, all over. Here's your answer, a faith-based ministry, and that's what I'm fighting for. Look, the colleges can't do it, your representatives and senators aren't going to do it, the president isn't going to do it.
We ain't going to do it.
They would have done it by now. You know who's going to do it? You are. The least of these that care. That's why Jesus said, and as much as you do it to the least of these, you've done it to me.
Amen.
You can make that difference.
Amen.
Look, I was no more than a drunken alcoholic that lost everything. And 17 years later, we now have the largest faith-based ministry in the state of Pennsylvania and have touched thousands of lives, made laws, literally have put Jesus' name into the Capitol, into every agency in this state. That's
Amen.
Something that you should be proud of.
Amen.
Amen.
That is something that should make you stand up. What do you want to stand up for in this day and age? You want to stand up for technology? Really? You want to stand up for Pokemon? What is it you want to stand up for? What's out there? What is out there for you? It's Satan. That's what's out there. You see it all the time here. People come, people go, they turn around, they come crawling right back. Over and over and over again.
That's right.
And when are you going to realize, for those of you that go out and come back, or those, you know, where are your friends at?
That's right.
This is your home. Where are they? I don't see them coming here to visit you.
Nope.
They got a whole week here. Where are they? Well, I'll bet you they'll get on the phone, get a hold of you, and say, hey, come on over, get some drugs, get some beer, alcohol, whatever, let's party, come on, get out of that place. I'll bet you'll get that from them.
Amen.
And you tell me that isn't Satan calling you. Absolutely. If they really cared about your life, they really cared about you, where are they? Why aren't they here?
That's right.
It's just like me. I couldn't drive past the bar without going in and drinking. Literally, I would not do it. Those friends are nowhere around. Now I drive through town, all I do is get flipped off.
Huh.
Yeah, I like it. It's okay with me, because that's what Jesus said would happen.
That's right.
He did.
It's sad.
Right.
For doing what? Helping a person.
That's right.
That's it. Isn't that what you want? Don't you want to be hated and flipped off a lot for helping people?
Yeah. Sure.
I mean, that's what Jesus said would happen. Instead, what do we want? We want to go to church all dressed up, get patted on the back, and told how wonderful we are.
Huh.
And so on, and have the preacher come to visit and enter. The traditional nonsense.
Hurt nobody.
That's nowhere in here. Jesus told his disciples, go and eat. Mm-hmm. I don't care if the Pharisees are watching. Mm-hmm. Well, they don't even wash their hands. Mm-hmm. He's totally opposite of everything that we think we know. Maybe I'll get here. Matthew 23. Now, a couple things I want to point out here. That gives you a quick review of some stuff. Matthew 23. Now, these are the woes to the Pharisees, but you have to understand what Jesus is coming off of when he begins to hammer the Pharisees. So, as you look at this, you're going to see prior to this in Matthew 22, okay, starting at verse 34. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees, what? To silence. Mm-hmm. Shut up!
Shut them up.
That's exactly what Jesus would do. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. So that's exactly what Jesus, you could come and ask him questions, and he's going to shut you up. Because he speaks to you in here. Compassion and love in here. The gossiping, the gnashing of teeth, the carrying on, the questioning, the doubting, that's all of Satan. That's what messes us up. Jesus wants you to be still and shut up and listen. And he'll speak to you if you want that. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, notice, here we go. Leaders, lawyers, Pharisees, scribes, etc. Asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all of the law and the prophets. Everything hangs on that. To love one another as I have loved you. Jesus became that example. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, What think ye of Christ? Whose son is he? They say unto him, The son of David. He saith unto them, How then doth David in spirit call him Lord, saying, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand, till I make thine enemies thy footstool. If David then call him Lord, how is he his son? And no man was able to answer. Again, he shut him up. So he basically said, because the Jews are waiting for the Messiah to come from David, etc. So here Jesus is, they won't believe him. So what does he do? In a few words, he shuts them up. They can't. He wants you silent to listen. Remember, it's like, you know, what we tend to do is we call up Jesus, we talk to him, and then we hang up. And we never listen. It's like we get our side out, and then we hang up. We're done. We don't want to listen. And then when he does speak, we don't want to hear what he has to say.
That's right.
That's called truth. And no man was able to answer him a word, neither durst any man from the day forth ask any more questions. They quit asking questions. Because see, either now or in the next life, Jesus is going to silence you. When you start questioning God and questioning him, people, that's not what we are to do. We are to listen to the light. He said, love thy neighbor as thyself. If you do that, you will not see the things you see today. Instead, we don't want to hear that. And look what our leadership has let happen. They will be responsible for that. Just like you're going to find out later on this week. Now, immediately after that, he's questioned, what's the greatest commandment? To love. And I am the Messiah. That's basically the statement he made. You love thy neighbors yourself. Love as I teach you, and I am the Messiah. Now he goes into the woes to the Pharisees. These are religious leaders that were of the highest religious sect that you can imagine. Okay, Paul was of the Sanhedrin. So he could have, you know, he was as powerful as Pilate. He could do anything. These are very powerful men. Okay, now what the Sadducees would do, they would have groups of anywhere from 14 to 16. There was approximately 460 some of them throughout the Jerusalem area. And that's where they would meet, okay? So they would meet in a room, and there'd be 12 or 14. That's where Jesus would go. When you read that Jesus went in and read the scripture, he would go in among those 14, and he'd read the scripture and leave, okay? Now, when he went in the temple, he went in the main temple and flipped over the tables. So that's how these Pharisees were. They were in their groups throughout, kind of like your township supervisors, you know, your borough, the city, the managers and everything, you know, the group in the borough. That's kind of how it was. Same thing. So they were in powerful positions. And Jesus, then spake Jesus, this is chapter 23, verse 1, then spake Jesus to the multitudes and to his disciples. So notice, he had his disciples right there. He had his disciples there, and their disciples were there also. Okay, so the multitude and his disciples were all there, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore, whatsoever they bid, you observe. That observe and do, but do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. So see, each one of these rooms, they had a seat in them. Okay, it was a stone seat, and that's where the highest Pharisee would sit when they had their group meeting of the Pharisees. So that was the seat of Moses. And throughout the towns, you had the seat. Okay, today we'd call it the chair. All right, who's going to chair the meeting? Okay, so that's what it would be. So your chair, and it's still the Old Testament falling into the New Testament. So each place would have a chair. Okay? And Jesus will walk in now and then and read the scripture and make them nervous and leave. So that's where they would be sitting. That's what he's talking about. The scribes and the Pharisees sit in the Moses seat. So they sit in that position of authority to read the law and to act high and mighty like they know it all. But Jesus says, all therefore whatsoever bid ye observe, that observe. So he's saying, you know, they're making, so today it would be, okay, they're making laws to protect us. You want to observe those laws, okay? Keeping the water clean in town, and they're right now we're on a mandatory, or maybe I don't think Brockway, Du Bois is, mandatory water, etc. You know, so you observe them, but don't do what they do, okay? You observe what you know is right and true to do, but don't do what they do because they don't even do it. Now, he's also comparing this, he's the main thing is he's pointing to his life, to love others, to care for others. Verse 4, for they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. See, the leaders of the towns, your government today, all right, and then they burden us with laws and laws and laws, but they don't do anything to help.
That's right.
But Jesus said, my burden is light. Jesus says, I'm not going to come and burden you. I want to remove those burdens. I want to give you peace in a time when you're being burdened by a world that doesn't really care about you. Look at the prior verses. Love your neighbor as yourself. That's not happening. So they keep burdening us and burdening us. So what do they do? Here, just an example. All right, you ended up on the Megan Law list, whatever, and then you go to prison, you serve your time, you paid your debt to society, and then you come out, and then all of a sudden they tempt you with Pokemon. It's like tempting. You know, burden. Here, Pokemon. Now they're saying, and if you touch it, you're going back to prison. It's like more burden. They burden you. Yeah, but they don't care. But Jesus saying, if you follow me, Jesus won't do that to you.
Amen.
Jesus saying, he said, if you want to care and love people and care for them and help them and bring them in and help them, I will never do anything to tempt you or mislead. No one can ever come up against that.
Amen.
Helping a human being, no one can ever touch that. It's your right as a human being. It's our constitutional right to do. Remember, the Constitution of the United States was built on what fundamentals that we have forgotten? The Ten Commandments. The conscience of man with God is what this country is built on. That's called natural common law. That's what holds up in the federal courts. That's why you get, now we're into the county seat, all right? There we go. The seat. The county seat where the judge is. It's not a constitutional court. He could go in there and run. It's burdensome. They're going to burden you. It's not. You are not. Did you vote on the Constitution? There's not one of us in here that voted on the Constitution. There wasn't anyone that voted on the Constitution. The Founding Fathers voted for us. So that's why in the county courts, in the county seats, you don't have a voice. When you say that's unconstitutional in your county court, forget it, because you are not a part of the Constitution. You never voted on it. So that's why you have to go to the federal level. You understand? That's why you have to push up to that. That's why the federal attorneys won't mess with the local yokels. They go right to the federal because they don't acknowledge the Constitution. See, because that's what Jesus said. They sit in their seats. They sit in there, and what do? They burden people and burden people, but they themselves don't care to help the people.
That's right.
You know, your county judge? Your county judge is in charge of CYS, parole and probation. There's your seat, you see? And if that man or woman does not know Jesus Christ and the conscience of man with God, they just do everything. They can do whatever they want. But if you get the federal court to come in and uplift the Constitution, there's where you have your rights. Well, in this case, Jesus comes in, and he is going to capitalize on that. How? By a way of life that can't be touched. That was one thing that at least our founding fathers acknowledged. See, we don't know that. This is another thing that you need to understand. When our Constitution was signed, 10 years later, the British troops were still here. Why? If we were a free country, why are they still here? Then we are in debt. We're in debt to the king. So our founding fathers said, here's what we'll do. We'll vote and to pay the debt to the king. I didn't vote on it. No one else voted on it.
Nope.
They did. And we've been paying debt to England ever since. Your taxes, everything you do, you're paying debt to the king. And you have. That's why then they legalized alcohol right away in 1787. They hurry up to pay taxes to pay the king. Why are they frantically paying the king? All of a sudden they're paying the king back, and the king's saying, hey, wait a minute, my corporation is doing pretty good. America's a corporation. I need banks. So the king, Rothschild, put in the banks. He started making the banks. That's where you get your Federal Reserve, which has nothing to do with the federal government. Nothing. It's a few people that run the whole world. We need to know that. Because this is exactly what Jesus was coming up against. Remember, Satan took him up on the mountain, said, I'll give you the whole world. Satan was quoting scripture. A few people was running the whole world. Today, same thing. Look, how do you think that they ended up getting a $7 billion, bailout of the banks? They went to the Federal Reserve. You know what the Federal Reserve did? One person. You're not going to know who that person is. There's 5 to 9 of them in the whole world. That's it. They run the whole world. You know what they did? They wrote a check out. It was a hot check. Here you go. Go ahead. Make $7 billion. That's it. That's the Federal Reserve. It's never been audited, ever. You know why they killed Kennedy? You know why John F. Kennedy was killed? Because he said, I will disembody the CIA. Meaning he is going to come and... He said, no, you won't. They shot him. And any president that tries to touch the Federal Reserve, the CIA, will be shot. They won't let it happen. That's why these men are too powerful. It's England, Roman Empire. This is where all of the end times come in. That's why the Pope came here not too long ago. Mm-hmm. Now he comes out and declares himself the Antichrist. You see that? He come out and declared himself the Antichrist. Now you have to understand what that means, because in the Catholic Church, anti actually means good, a resemblance of Jesus, the victor. He come out and said it. Every pope is Antichrist, but he is the Antichrist. That means he is going to be, just like Jesus, he is Jesus, but he is the official Antichrist. He come out and declared it publicly. Then he comes here into Philadelphia, and you have many other things taking place that you need to understand. We are nothing more than a corporation. You are nothing more than a product of the United States, and we were made that way by our leaders. I don't want to be a product. I want to be a child of the living God.
Amen.
I want to live for Christ, and I don't want to go up there and build a world that is literally ignoring hunger and ignoring incarceration, the mentally ill. I don't want to be a part of that, and you shouldn't either. So he says, for they find heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments, and love the uppermost rooms at feasts and the chief seats in the synagogues. And greetings in the markets, and to be called of men rabbi, rabbi. But be not ye called rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ, and all ye are brethren. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your father, which is in heaven. Neither be ye called master, for one is your master, even Christ. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. So he boils it all down to a servant. All that. But he just acknowledged everything you see on TV. You see it in your leadership, your senators, your representatives, in your leaders in your community. They walk around. They want to be acknowledged. They want to be voted. This is everything here. They have their phylacteries. Now, those phylacteries were, if you ever see a picture of a Pharisee, is a prayer box. Mm-hmm. So they either have it on their forehead or on their wrist. So if you see a picture of a Pharisee, you'll see a little box there or up here, and they would open up those boxes and bring out the prayer list and recite their prayers. So this is what Jesus said. Well, we're going to go pray about it. They go around, and they pray, and then they make their tassels look good. They make their garments look good so people can see that they're out there as ministers and priests. And Jesus said, don't, just ignore that. Say, this isn't what it's about. This is what's going to bring the world down. And it has. This kind of leadership. And it's still here today. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. It's going to take humility to usher in the coming of Christ. People, there is no hope for this world to get better. There's no getting better anymore.
Amen.
Christ is going to come. We can't undo. There's no undo button. We can't change what has happened. People, save your water and save your change. Mm-hmm. You could wake up any day and the dollar bill is useless. The dollar bill is worth 14 cents right now. Any day. Why? Come on. Let's go back to the colleges. How can you have Harvard and Princeton and all these colleges? And by the way, all those colleges supported the eugenic period. They were the major funds, yeah, funding for it. Yeah. How can you have these major colleges for decades and have a country that's broke? Trillions of dollars in debt. How do you teach that? How do you teach that? How do you have colleges of that degree that literally bring in innocent young men and women and put them in debt and throw them out into a world that they know could never fill their job profession? Is that intelligence? You just, no, what it is that you caused more grievance and more burden on that person. You brought them in and gave them hope. You made them get grants to get debt and debt and gave them hope of something that isn't even really up there.
Yep.
You gave them hope. You're trying to, you are trying to convince our young generation of people that there's hope in a country that's trillions of dollars in debt. Did you know that right now China is trying to force Obama. They're saying to him, you either pay the debt or we're going to come in and take over your major industries and your prime real estate. That's the end. This is the beginning of Gog and Magog, the end time. They're looking to do that. See, the thing is, though, is now listen, you have to be intelligent. Jesus said, he taught us what we'll live through it all is to help one another because we're going to need it. Mm-hmm. But people, do you really think that our leadership is that stupid that they're going to let the country go into $1 trillion in debt? No. They aren't stupid. They know that money is useless. The dollar bill is a promissory note. It's useless. To let it go up to trillions of dollars means nothing because they know that as soon as they collapse, what's going to be next? The yen or the euro? They know, as soon as the Federal Reserve collapses, then the rich are already in position and taken care of. Why do you think it's a frantic movement? It's now millionaires, billionaires, and next going to be trillionaires. Once they're locked into the gold and silver, they're good. They care less about us. Overnight. Right now, it's already happening in the United States. You can go into certain banks with cash to pay your mortgages, you'll deny it. They don't want your cash, dollars. Why do you think they're going around trying to get gold and silver everywhere? They're trying to get all the gold and silver coins. It's going back. Any currency that has a mint, okay, especially silver, is always going to be worth something. Save your coins. You got to save your change, whatever you do, and water. Because once they close, you're going to go up to your ATM or whatever, there's no cash. They're closed. It's going to happen overnight. I'm going to tell you something. You want to clean up? All you have to do is get the Federal Reserve, these few people, these leaders. You want to clean up the drug problem and everything else? Do away with the dollar bill. Where's the drug dealer? They're done. No money. What are you going to do? There's your drug. The dollar bill is worth nothing. Yeah. You want to clean the world up? The sex trafficking? Done. That's exactly what you're going to do. We're stupid enough that we're letting this happen. It's going to happen overnight. People change are like this.
That's right.
You better be careful with your cash out there. They don't care if they burden us. They do not care if they wipe it out. They don't care if you wake up tomorrow and the dollar bill isn't there because the rich are already set. Do you know you need to know this stuff in order to even begin to understand the Bible today? We aren't living 100 years ago. We aren't living back in the Old Testament. We aren't living back when Wesley and Calvin started the churches. We are living in 2016, and this nation is going to hell in a bucket fast. Yeah. And you got to do something about it as Christians. Look, we have people coming in here 19, 20, 21 years old with no hope. In 2016, who's going to care for them? You don't know how many people that left here and died in the streets after this. They could be alive right now if they would have stayed.
That's right.
This is happening all over the place. Mm-hmm. This is what God's going to see and what you're going to be responsible for once you hear it. It's sad. I sure hope you don't want to be a part of that. Do you know right now in the United States we have the largest gold mine in the world in the Grand Canyon locked up and sealed? I wonder why. Because they know when they collapse the dollar, the rich, they're taking care of to every nation. They're going to have it. We have the largest oil well in Alaska capped off. But yet our young men and women are dying over oil and we're sitting up there and untouched. This is all a few people putting a burden on our young men and women. Sacrificing their lives over oil and things of that nature when they're sitting on the most oil in the world.
Mm-hmm.
See, you got to put it in today. This is what is happening, and Jesus saying, listen, you have to obey the law, but you also need to see what they're doing, and don't do what they do.
Amen.
Don't support it and be a part of it. And we do. You buy Pokemon, you buy those drinks out there, all those, you go look at those, what are those drinks, the monster drinks and all that, satanic figures all over them. You'd be surprised at how much of the satanic forces out there, how much logos. Go look in your cartoons. You see a lot of satanic stuff. And when I say that, I can back it up because I personally met and know an individual who was born to be the satanic high priest in the United States by both cults of the satanic church. So I was able to hear it right from the horse's mouth, many of things. Walmart, big supporters of the satanic movement.
Yep.
Take a look on cartoons. One real quick, look at the star with the horns up. They're always, you look in there, you'll see them turned up.
Which one's on?
You look at the sports drink, claw 666. You got the degraded cross. Lots of that. It's all out there in your support. I'm not saying I didn't drink this drink, because I have. I tried it, but it's there. I don't think I'll drink anymore. But you'd be surprised what you're supporting. Like I tell you in here, you know, you think that getting food stamps, it looks like it's the government's way of helping you. No, it's not. All that, could you imagine what would happen if all the food stamps quit right now? Farmers would be done. It would, the grocery stores would be yelling. It would literally stop the economy. Mm-hmm. They're doing, you're just a product. You're there to keep it moving so the rich stays rich and their product can flow.
Yep.
They aren't doing it to help you. That's what they're doing. So there's less food rotting on the shelves. And there's what, they can push it through. So, as these Pharisees now, let me get back to them real quick. I'm going to point out a couple things, because we've got a few more nights to go through this. Okay, verse 13. Right after he says this, he damns them. He basically is damning the Pharisees. This is the leadership of all generations. He says, "But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites." Now, keep in mind, you know who the scribes are. You have to know who the scribes are. You have the Pharisees, and then you have the scribes. The scribes are the one that is are the reasons why we have the Bible. They are the men that would follow Jesus, the Pharisees, around and write everything down. Okay? When they would do it, they were highly educated, meaning they would write approximately 1,582 letters per page. So they would write it. And if the ink, now if you can imagine doing this, if the ink would touch any letter, they had to start all over again. It had to be perfect. Then it had to be counted, every letter, and then another scribe would have to count it and read it each page over and over again. Before, that is why the Bible was so accurate and kept. And so this was a scribe. So Jesus is talking to the Pharisees and the scribes sitting there writing down the things that are being said and done. "But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in." He just damned the leaders. These were men that were more religious than anybody walking the earth today. Even the Pharisees that are trying to be Pharisees today, they're above them. These men were highly religious to the T, and Jesus just come in and said, you're not going into heaven, but what you're doing is you're shutting heaven up. He's looking out for you, the people. He's saying, you are literally leading people to hell because they aren't hearing the truth of me, the true Jesus. They're following a false Jesus. What Jesus are you following? The Jesus that we are following would not let this happen to humanity.
Amen.
He would not let the mental illness happen, the mentally ill be abused. He wouldn't let people start. That's not the Jesus he's talking about. He's saying if you keep doing this, you are shutting up heaven. Look, how if you're not taught properly, how are you going to ever know who the true Christ is?
Amen.
How? And he's saying this is what you're doing. For ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in. You know, Charles Spurgeon, I like Charles Spurgeon a lot, and I use this a lot because it's so true. But Charles Spurgeon says there's going to be many a congregations in the fire of hell. And as their minister comes walking in, they're going to say, come on, minister, give us another one of your wonderful sermons. Look where it's put us. And that's right. What's happening.
That's right.
People, there's no answer. There's no way in the world. I can't do it, and I don't know how any. How in the world can in 2016, can I jump up and down and rejoice and say, hallelujah, praise the Lord, we're going to heaven, it's all going to be beautiful and wonderful, when every 5 seconds a child is dying, our prisons are maxed out, homelessness is everywhere, there's addictions everywhere, heroin deaths all over this county, everywhere, you have bath salts, you got people murdering each other, shooting each other. How in the world can we do that? That is such self-centeredness that it's above and beyond any self-centeredness I can ever think of.
Amen.
How in the world can we do that? You know, maybe back in the Billy Graham days or back in the Leave It to Beaver days, we could have done that. We're not in that anymore.
That's right.
We're in a day and an age when we should know better. Mm-hmm. How in the world in 2016 can we let children die of starvation in any country? How? It sickens me. I'm listening now to the radio over here in Dubois. They're using a minister that died last year as a ploy to donate money to get over to one of the countries to help the children. Oh, this is what this minister used to do, and we're having a dinner for him. You can donate to help the children and... And then I got to sit there on TV and I got to watch Donald Trump try to raise $10 million when he has $10 billion. Now, wait a minute. It doesn't end there. This put me over the edge. I'm going to end up wearing a punching bag out. Because it's just going. It's in New York, there's this skyscraper. Did you see that in the news? This thing's huge. I don't know, I'll hide it. It cost $10 million to live there. In one place. $10 million! I mean, I'm like, well, it's sinking. It's sinking 16 inches, and it's starting to lean. Imagine that. How do you do that one? Now, you thought $10 million, and there's how many levels, and you can imagine the money, and I'm thinking, because I'm thinking of this, can you imagine, now this thing is, I didn't get the details, but it looks like one of the biggest skyscrapers, you know, I could just see the architects patting each other on the back and talking such a wonderful thing, you know, looking good and everything else, and here it is, sinking 16 inches, and now they're going to have a huge court case, because is it the owner, or is it the engineers, or who's responsible? Millions, billions of dollars on man's error. Well, there's starvation, there's hunger, and it's just out of place, people. It's wrong. You know what else made me sick is when you take that and I was sitting there watching TV again, the news. I don't watch the news or UFC, either UFC Fight Night or the news. That's about all I want. But and the reason I watch UFC is because it's real. I don't like people messing with my head. You know, one of the worst things that I can do is watch a Bigfoot story, because you know they get to intrigue you. You know. It's like you think they're almost going to tell you, you know, and then at the end they just drop the bomb. Well, we aren't sure. And it's like, you just mess with my intelligence again. And that drives me nuts, because they do that a lot. Because, you know, in 2016, after years of thinking, you know, because I do have a theory on that Bigfoot thing, goes back to the asylums. But anyhow, it's like, you know, at least in 2016, someone's going to give us something. So at least the UFC's real. You know, what I'm seeing is real and it's happening and it's not messing with my head. If they start holding up signs like the wrestling does and it gets out of hand, I'll be done watching it too. I want it to be real. When he's knocked out, he goes, oh yeah, he's out. Okay. So, I forgot where I was going.
Something being real.
Donald Trump asking for money.
Oh, I know what it was. Okay, and I'm watching TV, and this lady was a little child, says, this about put me over there. If we had enough money, this little child won't die of cancer if you donate. Man, I thought, how can you do that to us? If we have enough money, we can find a cure, and this child won't have to die from cancer. You have a skyscraper, $10 billion, this going on, you have Donald Trump with billions, you have millionaires. Imagine, and I'm sitting there thinking, well, if you have that many millionaires that can buy a $10 million floor on a skyscraper, how in God's name can you put a little child and call ourselves Christians on TV and say, if? Oh, but you know what? NASA just sent up a space station or rocket or whatever it was with 3D cameras on it.
Yeah.
Oh, isn't that wonderful?
Awesome.
Millions and billions of dollars so we can say, oh, look at that picture. And another child dies. And you can do that. It's just wrong. We are in a messed up world as Christians. So, really, as you look at this, this is one of the reasons why. And I want to read these couple things just to explain for the rest of the week a little bit of where we're going here. Now, the Pharisees, you had a couple different characteristics. You had what was known as the shoulder Pharisee. And this was the one that would wear all of his righteous good acts up on his shoulders. You know, he always dressing up, looking good, and out in the community, and acting like he's doing all these good deeds. They were known as the shoulder Pharisees. Then you have the wait a little Pharisee. All right, always want to wait a little. Now these are the ones that always intend to do good deeds, but always find a reason to do them later. Mm. They intend to do it, but they always want to do it later. Now these were all characteristics of Pharisees of that day. So that's no different than the leaders of our day to apply that. Wait a little Pharisee, while we'll get to it. Then you got the bruised and bleeding Pharisee. Alright? And this would have been who was so holy that he would turn his head away. Okay? So he would turn his head away from like the poor and or even the women in public. He would turn away and he would just beat himself up. And he was constantly, because of it, because he was so much trying to stay away from anything to make him look bad, he was constantly tripping and bumping into things and hitting things. You know, maybe he was following Pokemon, because that's happening a lot. So maybe he knew something we didn't know yet. And so that's what they called the bruised and bleeding Pharisee, okay? He was following something that wasn't there. Then you got the humpback Pharisee, okay?
Uh-oh.
So, and you do. You got these leaders out there. They try to stay away from everything to look great. Then you got the humpback Pharisee. And this was the one that was so humble, you know, he would walk so bent over, you know, that and barely lifting up his feet so people would look and just see how humble he really was, you know. He put on this show, like Jesus said, that they are just so humble and peaceful and wonderful. So that's the kind of Pharisee you had. Then you have the always counting Pharisee, who was always counting up his good deeds and believed that God would, he would put God in debt to him for all the good that he had done. So you actually have these Pharisees. Paul was one of them, you know, and that he would count up all his good deeds like as if you put God in debt. Now God has to pay me back for what I have done. Now God does not do a thing for He took care of that on the cross.
Amen.
Then you have the fearless Pharisee, okay, or I'm sorry, the fearful Pharisee, who did good because he was terrified that God would strike him with judgment if he did not. Okay? And that's not the way to serve God. You shouldn't fear him like if you don't. Look, we're all going to make mistakes. We'll never be perfect in what Jesus wants us to do. But we can all, as a body, we can all support and be a part of it. And then you had the God-fearing Pharisee who really loved God and did good deeds to please the God he loved. So there was those who would do that, but that wasn't the way to heaven. It was only through Christ. The New Testament was coming, and Jesus was trying to get that through their head, that there's a New Testament by through me, through Jesus Christ, you will have eternal everlasting life. That there isn't anything we can do to please God. We can never be good enough. So Jesus died for that, but that doesn't mean that we don't live for him. That's why Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. Okay? That life is your book. Every day you have an empty page, and every day you have an opportunity to live that life. Not deeds, not works, a life. A characteristic to help others. But first, you have to put yourself in a place to do that. Your traditional church, it's not there. Look, people, we need to start understanding that Jesus was a pretty tough individual. Jesus was not what we've been led to think he is.
Amen.
He was a man that when he came in that temple with a whip, first of all, he went and made the whip. He just didn't go grab a whip. He went and made it. So he was pretty indignant. He had to go and get himself in order. Now, this was a man that was a carpenter. Jesus, so when Jesus, you hear this story, what happened to Jesus between 12 and 30 years old? Where was he? You get that question. It's like, it's not in the Bible. Oh, it's in the Bible. It's right there. Well, what do you mean it's right there? From 12 to 30, it's right there. He told us all about it. See, Jesus was a carpenter. He built houses. So remember he said, he knew what it was like to carry a beam. Now, I built houses for over 20 years. When you carry a beam, you can't see through it, can you? So you got to get that beam out of your eye. You got to get it down before you can see your buddy over there. See? So, things like that. What about the Good Samaritan? Jesus was a very different person. He wasn't well liked. He knew what it was like to get rolled in the street. He knew what it was like to go and beg for bread. He knew what it was like to go and stand in town and try to find work and a job. Jesus lived out all the parables you read in the Bible. That's where he was from 12 until 30. He tells us all about it. He was a man who loved people, who had calloused hands. Dirty, he stunk. He didn't, you know, they didn't have that stuff we had today. He was very down to earth. Now, when you walked, he would walk everywhere you go. He didn't jump in a car. He walked. Now, carpenter was also a stone layer. It was mostly stone. Jesus was a very physically fit man. When Jesus walked into that temple with a whip, and his adrenaline was flowing, the veins in his neck and his arms and his muscles would have been bulging to the point where it scared the Pharisees and the people in there to death. It wasn't a wonderful little man walking in a white robe with fluffy hair, all joyful. It was a man that if he were
right.
Walked in here right now, I would assure you, all of you would be heading that way. Amen. You would want nothing to do with them.
Right.
That's the Jesus we serve.
Amen.
He was to the point. He was not anything like we have been being taught, and that is why we're in the condition we're in. But his love for you is so great. It is. But he wants to get your attention. He wants you to know him as a friend. He wants to be able to take you for a walk through the things you've heard here tonight to help another. That's where he wants you to follow him. There's people that need you out there. You have an opportunity to take all the things that you've been through in life and help another person.
Amen.
That's why
Amen.
You've been through them. Now you have an opportunity to do it. The world out there isn't going to do it. They aren't going to help you. You're a product. You're making them money. You need to start helping each other in the name of Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
And you'll see people delivered from their addiction, from depression. See, now Jesus didn't tickle ears, and he didn't play games like we see today. And because of it, we have fallen Laodicea and lazy to the point where we're ignoring the very things that's going to damn a lot of people to hell. How in the world can we follow this Pokemon and ignore starvation of children? Do you know that there's close to 33,000 homeless children in your Pennsylvania schools? Did you know that? 33,000. Never would have thought, would you? Did you know that most of them go home hungry? They don't have food in the house. That's a reality here that we don't see. And the churches are locked up and closed. Churches should be open 24/7 in every town.
Amen.
24/7 in every town. Mm-hmm. Any minister that leaves and locks up his church should be damned to hell.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
This is exactly what Jesus is saying here. I'm not telling you anything that Jesus didn't already say. This is what he just said. And it's going to get worse. Because at the end of this, he says, how are you going to escape the damnation of hell? Unless you want to hear from a different Jesus, then you better go somewhere else. If you want your ears tickled. Because
right.
here it's not going to be.
That's
it
right.
can't
Jesus.
Be. See, if Jesus was here today, he'd make you very nervous. If he come in and sat down beside you, he'd make you very nervous. You wouldn't like it, I will assure you. All he would have to do is look at you, and you would not want him anywhere near you. I will assure you of that. It would be very scary. Especially if he looked at you, because he looked right to your soul, the very thing he created. And you would know it. Now you know why Peter was so nervous and Thomas and all of them. See, because Jesus was looking at them in a way that no one else could. Peter said, get away from me. I don't want you near me. Thomas ran around doubting. But yet, this is a radical man that came in and flipped over tables, was doing radical things, but yet they still followed him. They gave their life for him. Who killed him? All the disciples, the leaders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the governors, the kings, the leaders. Why were they killed? Because they tried to help the least of these that the world didn't want. Look, people, I'm sorry to tell you this. This isn't going to happen, and it's real. We are very barbaric people, and I'm sorry to have to tell you that, just because we dress up like this and go out in society and try to look good, our rich are very barbaric people. You will see before long that there's going to be human hunting taking place. So much so, it's going to be legalized as sport for the rich. Look, I'm not saying that because it's something that I want to say or it's my opinion. I'm saying that because the international society has already declared it. Not that they only declare it, they said by 2020 it will be legalized. That the rich will have clubs, that they will actually have the sport of hunting humans.
What?
And it will be legal.
Wait a minute.
There's where our leadership and mindset is going. That's what they think about people, no different than they were thinking of those mentally ill in the early 1900s when they laid them on an operating table and butchered them, knowing they would die. And you know what? They will actually think that they are doing society a favor by doing it.
Yep.
That's why in John 16, Jesus says, and they will kill you, thinking that they do God a service. This is your leader. This is what we're talking about. Now, I'm going to end with this. Go do some research on the Roman Empire. You will find that pretty much everything going on in the United States is a duplicate of the Roman Empire right before it collapsed. That was everything. Remember, all roads back then, it was all roads lead to Rome. It was the big deal. Well, what has America been? Everyone wants to run to America. That's ready to happen. When it does, you have Russia and China just sitting back waiting. The euro, the yen, the commerce, they're sitting back waiting. And all it's going to take is the Rothschild organization and some other few people to make one decision overnight. And the world, as you know, is going to change drastically. I really encourage you to save your change. Save your coins. Look for any silver coins. If you have them, save them. And keep them. And water. Right now, they are already, the water levels are low. The city waters are, where is the Olympics at this year?
Rio.
Rio? Okay. The water there, did you see that in the news? All the water is impure. To the degree where they think that everyone can get sick there, it's contaminated with feces, everything. Look, people, for safe water, the ocean can't filter it anymore. Another thing, all of the psychotropic drugs and prescription medications you take, the chemicals in them cannot be filtered out of the water through the septic system. So in our major cities, all that goes through, they filter the water. Those chemicals cannot be removed from the water. The ocean cannot remove it from the water. That is now, there is traces in our water of somebody else's drugs that they've been taking. This is where the water became bitter. People were there. All right? I'm not up here. I'm not one of these end times. It's here. No. The facts are there. Everything is in place. Now you need to make a decision. You either we need to just continue on, or you can help each other. Now, by doing that, I mean you will usher in the coming of Christ. Right. That's our only hope. We don't know the day or time, but that's what. There's a great division. I'm going to tell you right now, I stand on this with my last breath. If people would wake up in our communities, in this nation, this state, and this world, wake up and open up the doors of the churches, quit judging, and just start helping people in the name of Jesus with food, with medical attention, with the things they need, in a real revival way throughout, you would see the return of Christ.
Amen.
You would
Amen.
See. He said, are you ready? It's in our hands. Amen. But if we continue to wait, we aren't going to see the return of Christ like we think. We're going to see his judgment come like that. That's what's going to happen. You can apply that rapture in there. I'm not going to go into that right now. Okay, not enough time. But you can throw that in there wherever you want. But it's either that. Either we're going to keep our eyes closed and his judgment's going to hit. Or we can begin to start living his life and he will return. But the thing is, he's not going to return like you think. You know, this idea, people say, you know, they're standing there and they you think you're going to see Jesus, every eye will see him. Like what, you're going to sit there watching Channel 6 News and say, well, by George, Ethel, look at that, there comes Jesus. He's coming down out of heaven. Come on, this is your Lord and God. That's not going to happen. But that's what people think. You're going to be there in your armchair and say, yep, in the Bible, there he is. Oh, honey, what's he look like? Tell me, what's he look like? I mean, this, no, that isn't it at all. Then they say, oh, every computer will have it, so you'll be able to see it. You think your God's going to return and you're going to watch him on a computer? Well, oh, wait a minute. Maybe you'll be following Pokemon and all of a sudden, oh, it's Jesus. Why, look at that. That's how crazy we are. What's going to happen, people, is when we do that, when he comes, when this happens, we're going to realize he's been here the whole time in our hearts, our mind, and our spirit. Yes, we're going to see him. Yes, it's going to happen. It's going to be so powerful and beautiful and mighty. We're going to realize he never left us. He was in our hearts and our minds and our life.
Mm-hmm.
You want to see him on Channel 6 News. Nonsense. Well, more to come the rest of the week. We gotta get it in order. It just gets under my skin a little bit, you know what I mean? But, so we're gonna continue on with the Pharisees, we'll continue on with the woes, and we'll go into that more tomorrow night, okay? But you have to understand, you have to see, and you have to grasp, okay, the leadership of today, the leadership of then, and where Jesus is in our hearts, mind, and soul, okay?
Amen.
And what he wants of us to do in our lives. He wants to change your life. He wants you to have the best possible life you can have. I'm going to tell you something. People, how many times does he have to knock you down before he's trying to get you to just to shut up and say, look, I want you to live for me.
That's right.
Maybe that's all he's asking you. All you have to do is do that and your whole life could change.
Amen.
Don't sit there and stir your brain and try to think, well, I'm going to do this and do that, go back with my buddies, my friends. Stop! Listen to your God, your Creator, to Jesus.
Amen.
You don't have to worry about money. You don't have to worry about problems. If you give it all to him and take your step one at a time, and he'll take care of it, believe me. I guarantee it. Don't ask questions. Not too many anyhow. But let him be your God and Lord. Let his love and forgiveness touch you. By doing that, look at each other and help each other. Don't backbite each other. Don't stab each other in the back and backbite each other and gnash your teeth. Your family here. Work together in the name of Jesus.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Just for Jesus. It's not like you're being tricked, you know. You're not walking into something just for Jesus. Help each other. That's what it's all about.
Amen.
You know, the gossiping and the that's what's out there.
Mm-hmm.
Help each other here.
Don't talk.
And your friends that are calling you, trying to act like they're friends and getting you to go, tell them if they're your friends, come here.
Amen.
Let's get this together.
Amen.
Help
Amen.
Each other. Come. Let's hear about the Lord.
Amen.
Look, I don't have anything to give you. I don't have anything except a testimony. That's it. And what I have here, that's it. But I'm not giving. This is God's. It's not mine.
Amen.
It's God's. God took me from the pit of the grave, man. I was dead. I was a dead man. And he touched me and gave me life in 94. That's all I know.
Amen.
Christ is real.
Amen.
That's all I know.
Amen.
And I gave it all to him. I didn't tell him I was going to give it all. I didn't say I'm going to give it all if you help me. No, no. He came into my life. And he touched me. And he changed my life. And we're here because he can do that for you.
That's right.
Amen.
You want to see Jesus? It could be the person sitting right beside you. It could be the next person who walks through that door. It could be a family member that you got to call and tell them you love them and you're sorry. It could be anyone like that. Start speaking it and living it. Watch what happens. Oh, it's going to be hard because you got to change who you are.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? It's worth it. Doesn't mean you're not going to grumble. You're going to grumble. Probably more than you ever grumbled before.
Huh.
Because now you got God telling you what to do, not yourself. Yourself is your worst enemy.
The flesh.
Yeah. So then you do. You do just what Paul says. The two spirits war together. So quit fighting each other and start having your debates with Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Let him have it now and then. Tell him all about it.
Mm.
That's what he's there for. Just tell me.
Talk about
it. You want to get upset? Let him have it. He understands it all. But just remember, shut up and listen to what he tells you, okay? And we'll go into this more later. All right. I'm going to shut up at that. Let's go ahead, and as we close up tonight, you know, we form, for those of you that are new here, we've been forming some small groups and having some prayer. You're welcome to join. Do you want to grab your signs? We did this a couple years ago. So Bob and Ina and someone's got to take Sarah's place, correct?
Doug's here too.
Doug? Yeah. And like, here's the anger group. They're going to meet. Wherever you see the anger sign, you just can gather together and just pray about the anger issues. And there's a couple other ones. Most importantly, if there's anyone here tonight, look, if you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're doubting or you're not sure, you don't have to be. Look. It starts by speaking it in here. And look, you can come up here. I'll be up here. You can come to the steps. I'll pray with you. You can, you know, about Christ, if you want to ask him in as your Lord and Savior. And look, people, it could be your moment. It's not because you say a prayer or because I'm here. It's none of that. It's the day of salvation, that moment when you truly say, Christ, it's time. You know, and that's where you begin. You have to speak it in here. Okay? You have to profess it with your mouth and in your heart and speak it. That's the beginning. You might not even understand what that means, but you don't have to. Remember, God's your creator. God's the one that guides and directs you. Okay? That's what he says. You've got to, you know, he who humbles himself, humble yourself, God will take over. But that's an exercise. Paul says that's a spiritual exercise, is a tonic for your soul. Okay? So that's where you begin. That's all I'm here for, is I'm helping to exercise with you, okay? And you know, so if you want to come forward for salvation, if you take your last breath tonight, you're going to be with God? That's serious stuff, people. You want to be. So don't leave here doubting, okay? Don't doubt. You can leave here knowing for sure.
Thank you for listening to my sermon. Please continue to listen to others, for they're all connected. There's so much information I'd like to share with you. I have books available, teaching available. You may contact me directly at Bishop Jack Wisor, 814-590-3898. You ever know of anybody in need, please have them call. As Lord leads, we'll do our best to help them in their time of need.